book covers, page 581.
Burdens,
time of the young man. Come on down.
Slap on it.
I don't think I need a microphone for you.
Yes.
It's the blue.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I have a different face greeting you this morning. I'm usually sitting in the congregation. But you know what? I grew up sitting right where you are because this is my church from birth on. So I feel very comfortable in this church and looking at children. Although when we were growing up, a lot of you here, including my sister, we didn't have a minister who had a children's time. We just were intended to sit and be quiet. But I have something for you, which we didn't do very well. Regardless of universal, it is not a Presbyterian table, is it?
It's for all denominations.
Very, very good.
It's for you, the universal Christian church.
And we are part of that church, aren't we? The invitation comes from the Lord, doesn't he? And that's what that invitation is for you. All I am is his hand. Morning to hand that to you, because we want everyone to come and celebrate. And what does that table mean to us?
It remembers Jesus Christ, our Savior, who sacrificed his life so we may have forgiveness.
Anybody else want to add to that? What it is also is a table of inclusion. It means we are part of God's family. And we share with one another, don't we? Yes, we do. And I am proud to be a part of you this morning, and I know this entire congregation is, because you are our future, and you will be the ones that extend that invitation to the rest of the world.
We'll make decisions for ourselves about looking back in the past, see what we can better do in the future.
I think we're in good hands, don't you? Yes, we are.
Okay.
Will you pray with us? You want to pray, Tom?
Heavenly Father, I come to you in prayer to give you great thanks for the gifts you have given to us and the talents you bestow upon us. Help us to be children of God in the ways that are holy. Help us to include everyone. Amen.
And I would like to add, dear Lord, thank you for including all of us in Colin's life and these children's lives, and help us to be a good guide for them for the rest of their days. In God's name we pray. Amen.
Well, I'd love to get this.
invited somewhere. The Bible itself is an invitation. From Genesis to Revelation, we read of times where we are invited to come to God and to share the truth of God's love. Call from Abram through Revelation. The invitation, come to me. Psalmist said, oh, come, let us bow down. Isaiah said, oh, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. Jesus said, follow me. Revelation, the words, the Spirit and the Bride say, come. Paul, in talking about communion, quotes Jesus, my body is broken for you. The Bible is an invitation to find God, to find life, and to find ourselves. Now, scripture recorded by Matthew, the total context there is Jesus working with his disciples, and they're hungry, so they go to the cornfield and start getting corn. Unfortunately, it happened to be on the Sabbath day, so all the religious people got fired up and complained to Jesus that he was letting them break the law. Jesus turned and healed someone on the Sabbath. They said, you're not from God, you're from devil to be healing on the Sabbath. Jesus responding to that recognized that people wanted God. They're praying for God. And Jesus said, come unto me. Invited them in that context. In verse 14, he talks of healing the man and the Son of God. And he tells how the religious leaders, Matthew tells how the religious leaders charged Jesus with healing by the power of the devil. They were constantly beating him up on what he was doing. And he recognized the need of the people and the desire of the people to find God, to find and identify and have a relationship with their Creator. It's natural that our motivation is to be at peace with our Creator. Be at peace with others, to be at peace even with ourselves. And the religious leaders make a terrible burden on people to try to find the relationship with God that was nurturing and real and was joyful. The burden of self-punishment was so evident to those people. And then Jesus said, come to me. Come to me, those who are burdened, tired, and trying to follow the laws of religion. Come to me, those who are weary and looking for God. I will give you rest. I will show you God. Now think about the fact that Jesus said, come to me, and you'll find rest for your soul. You see the old struggle of grace versus law. The law said you've got to do this, you've got to do that, and you've got to make up for your sins, and you've got to do all these good deeds to cover yourself. But Jesus said, God is a God of love. You can't find forgiveness in what you do. You find forgiveness in God. That's what grace is. The self-giving of God to you is unmerited favor that he bestows upon us. Saying that Jesus has paid the penalty for you. You can boldly come to God. You don't have to climb up or crawl down to find God. God comes to you and offers himself and invites you to come to him. In Jesus, we find God. We find our struggle and that we keep putting before ourselves to reach God. We find that he is the way. In Jesus, we find peace. We find peace with ourselves where we can understand the fullness of God. It's like the little sign that's in the garden. I come here to find myself. It's so easy to get lost in the world. We get lost in the world, don't we? We get lost in the world when we try to build our lives focused on ourselves alone, we get lost when we leave God out and go our own way. We get lost in the world when we live only for ourselves. We need to find the peace of God. Jesus offers that. There's an old story, you may have heard it, about some merchants were moving through Africa, and they had a lot of merchandise, and they hired some natives to help them carry it across the desert, this long journey. And they were making a good pace across, and they would stop it in the evening and rest and start going again. After about 3 days, the natives wouldn't get up. And the merchants went and asked their leaders, "What's wrong? Why don't they get up?" They said, "You don't understand. In Africa, they feel that if they travel too fast, they must stop and let their souls catch up with them." You ever feel that way? Sometimes we have to stop and let our souls catch up with our lives. Jesus invites us to come and find peace with God and peace with ourselves. And in discovering that He is inviting us to discover God, it comes to us out of His love rather than us trying to climb up to God through religion. Using religion, that we really know God. This reminds us that the church must proclaim, "Come to God." That is who we are and what we're about. In Revelation 22nd chapter, the 17th verse, there's that great invitation that says, "The Spirit and the Bride say, Come." And the Spirit is the presence and the Spirit of God moving, inviting us to come to God. But the bride is the church. We're called to take up that endeavor to show to the world that God is inviting us to come to Him through Jesus Christ. That's our task, to share that. I served as the associate pastor for a while in the First Church of Tampa, Florida. It's an old Spanish architecture, the building is, and across the bay, there's an ark in concrete or some nothing. There's spelled out in old English letters, "The Spirit and the Bride say, Come." And it appears that the artist was kind of running out of space at the end, and the last two words he kind of put together. And it looks like, when you first go in, "The Spirit and the Bride sausage." And it's interesting to watch people get something, come in and look at that and try to figure out what in the world is that say up there. It says, "The Spirit and the Bride say, Come." God invites us, so should you and I as a church be living lives that are inviting others to come to the understanding and come to know God, know the reality of it, what it means. That's what the church is about, showing God's love by our lives, by our words, and by our deeds, that we show that God is love. And the church is a vessel of invitation, but sometimes it's a cracked vessel. And we don't always get it right. Sometimes we fall on our face. But we're called to keep trying and bringing out the love of God and expressing it to a world that's searching. Know that God's love is there for us. We do that locally, and we do that globally, as we share through our gifts, through our words, through our activities, what God is calling us to do and to be. We're together, and we come to this table. We come to be reminded of God's invitation, and we partake in what God has given us through the broken body of Christ, the shed blood of Christ. We can discover again God's value He places on us and now His love for us. And we do it together. Communion is we come in common together. Not very much like the old railroad tickets where it said not good and detached. You and I are not were separate from the church, but we remember who we are and wherever we are, and we come to the table of God and celebrate. A story is told where a lady off the street in Scotland was struggling to find an understanding of herself and God, and she went into a church. They were having communion, and she dared not partake because of her sin and her history. But an old Scottish elder took the plate and went to her and said, "Take it, lassie, take it. It's for ye." And indeed, the papal sacrament is for you and for me. Amen. Won't you please stand and let us affirm our faith by using the Nicene Creed printed in the bulletin. We believe in one God, Father, and Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake,
praise his name as we sing hymn 735.